be the last thing on my mind. Yeah, I was all but lost in the moment. I was young and running wide open. It was just another summer night. Had to be the last thing on my mind. When love. Said I'm yours, the first time I called you Lord. You hit the mark.
When love
Amen. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to church. Will you stand to your feet as we declare that our God is an amazing God and we are ready to worship the Lord? Amen. Come on, put your hands together and let's worship our King Jesus. This is not a spectator sport. We're called to worship. We're called to be in the sanctuary to give God glory. We're called to give God praise. And so we do that freely. We say, thank you, God, that you are the beginning and the end. You are the beginning and the end. So that means that I can call on you at any point in my life, at any season in my life, and you are there. Where can I go to hide from your love? Where can I go to escape your faithfulness? No one and nowhere. Amen. You are Alpha and Omega.
Alpha and Omega.
For the beginning and the end.
The beginning and the end.
For the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Yesterday, today, and forever.
I praise your name.
Your name.
I praise your name. You are Alpha and Omega.
Alpha and Omega.
You're the beginning and the end.
The end, the end.
You're the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Yesterday, today, and forever.
I praise your name.
Your name.
I praise your name. You are Alpha and Omega. You're the beginning and the end. You're the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Yeah.
You made a way. When there was no way. And so I believe.
I
see you do it.
I
see you move. I
see you move.
I see you. Is that your testimony? I know you can move. Cause I see you do it. I
see
you do it. I remember when God. I
see
you do it. I remember when God. I
see
you move. I know you've seen God do it. Oh, Lord. Oh, God. So we thank you for coming. Welcome to the Lighthouse, where we love our God and we love to worship our God. Come rain, sleet, or snow, we're going to be in the house of God giving him worship. It's the least we can do. Amen. reading in Revelation how the angels are around the throne of God, and they are singing different songs, and all of the songs are just bringing glory to the Lord and worshiping the Lord and giving God his glory and his honor and his majesty. And I thought to myself, well, that's what we should be doing. We should be at all times giving God glory and majesty, and not just because we were just created to do it. See, we have a relationship with God that the angels do not have. The angels don't know him to be a forgiving God. Amen? The angels don't know him to be a sacrificial God like we do. They were just created for one purpose, and that's all they get to do. But us, we get to worship him, and sometimes we fall down and we get back up again, and we give God glory anyhow. And we have a way to be able to say, thank you, God. You rescued me from my rebellion. You rescued me from my wayward ways, and I'm in the sanctuary to give you glory. No angel can say that. So we give God a special thanks, a special hallelujah. Amen. Anybody been redeemed today? Anyone ready to give God a special hallelujah? We thank God for what he's doing in our church, in the lives of our believers. You know, as a church staff, we're constantly praying for our church. We're constantly praying that we would have people who are on fire for the Lord. We want to see every seat filled with people who are dedicated and excited to the work of God. And so we thank God that we see him doing that. We see him answering our prayers. Amen. One such way is in the life of our youth, in the life of our young adults. So much has happened over the summer for them. And so, first of all, thank you all for participating, and thank you for all for giving. Amen. Amen. It is by your giving that we bring them food, and we bring them events, and we bring in guest speakers, and we give them to-go things. And last night we had a 90s night for the young adults, and they came with their bangle earrings and their flip-up glasses like Dwayne Wayne, you know? Nobody knows Dwayne Wayne? Okay. You got me. It's 80s, 90s, right? It's all the same. And they learned about commitment and dedicating their lives to the Lord. And what was so interesting is that our guest speaker had us kind of scale different things in our lives. How passionate are you about sports? How passionate are you about eating and working out? And some people were slapping the board with 10s on there. Oh, I love to eat, 10. Oh, I love sports, 10. And we were slapping 10s up there. We're 8s and high up there. And then the last one, she said, well, how is your relationship with the Lord? And truthfully, we were going up there, we're putting 7s, and we were putting 8s, and we were trying to be honest and putting 6s and 5s. And it called to our attention that there is room for passion for the Lord, that there is room for growth for the Lord. It's challenging us in our lives to not have any place that we kind of hold. I'm going to serve you, just not in this area. And I'm going to serve you, just not right here. So we thank God for what he's doing in our service. God is calling you right now. If you have not volunteered, if you have not joined, if you have not done whatever it is that you need to do, if you have an area that you're holding in the back pocket, God is saying it is time for you to not just show up, but grow up. God is asking for commitment from you. Amen. God is asking for commitment from you. God is asking for commitment from you. Amen. It's time. We started the year saying it's time. And I'm going to remind you, as we are wrapping up July, we're wrapping up the first half of the year, and we're going into the next half. Take a look back. Have you grown? Have you grown? Have you been coming to your Bible study? Have you been in your small group? Have you been praying for your neighbor? Have you incorporated fasting? Have you incorporated worship in your time at home? Have you grown? And if the answer is no, God is saying, it's time. It's time. It's time. So I invite you all, if you have not done so right now, open up your phones, scan that little QR code on the chair in front of you, and sign up for something. Sign up for anything. If it's a small group, get in it. If it's a Wednesday night Bible study, get in it. If it's to serve somewhere, get in it. God is saying, it's time to not just show up, but to grow up. Amen. Anybody willing? Anybody willing? Hallelujah. God bless you.
Be strong and courageous. Don't look at the people. people's faces. My God is good, he don't forsake us. I am living proof to say this. Be strong and courageous. Don't look at the people's faces. My God is good, he won't forsake it. Lions and cobras.
Working. Don't get left behind. God is a mighty God, and he's willing and able. You see, she said her prayer was that God would surround her with like-minded people that would encourage her to do the same. If that's your prayer, I ask you to stand to your feet and say, God, I'm in some mess right now. I'm surrounded by messy people, and quite honestly, I'm a little messy myself, but I'm asking you to be a mighty God. Reach down into the mess, into the muck and mire, and snatch me up out of this thing, and turn me around, and place my feet on a solid rock. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. Say, Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord, you're mighty.
Lord,
come on,
you're mighty.
Say, Lord, you're mighty. It's a declaration.
Lord, you're mighty.
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 Say, Lord, you're mighty.
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 Oh, Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth.
Sing it out with me. You said.
Great you are.
Jesus. Bless the name of Jesus. We thank you, God, for all that you have done, for all that you are. We have a new song that really blessed me when I heard it, because it just walks us through the gospel. We don't need fancy words, and we just tell what the Bible says. And we worship God just for what he says, just for who he said he is. We thank God for the declarations that he has made over our lives. We thank God that we love him and he loves us first. We thank you, God, that he's healing right now. I walked in here last week, back, toe up. We had a moment in worship and I said, God, just speak. Just speak. And in that morning I said, God, I just need you to heal my back. Heal my back. And since that, stand before you in all earnesty and say, I thank God that he's a healer. I thank God that he's a healer. And sometimes the issue might seem small and you don't think that God is worried about those kinds of things, but I want you to know that even in the little things, he's your God. Even in the little things, he's your God. Even in the big things, he's your God. And so we worship our God today.
There is no one. fulfilled in Jesus.
Suffering, serving,
suffering, serving. Oh, the blood of Jesus.
Resurrection and life.
Resurrection and life. Death has died in Jesus.
Word of the Father.
Yeah.
takes away the sin of the world. He takes away the sin of the world. Oh, I can sing that forever. He's the Lion and Lamb. All things were made through Jesus. He's the Lion and Lamb. Lion and Lamb, we overcome. Lion and Lamb, Lion and Lamb, we away. Look in the mirror and say, he's the Lion, Lion, and therefore I'll overcome by Lion and Lamb. I'll overcome by Jesus alone. Will we give God glory and give him praise? Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. 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 Peace and he's strength all at the same time. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. I don't care the mental disease, the mental disorder. I don't care the cancer prognosis. I don't care what you're coughing up at home. He's the Lion and he's the Lamb. He's peace and he's war at the same time. He's comfort and he's battle, all fighting for you. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Will you be encouraged today? Be encouraged today. Lion and Lamb, I overcome. Hallelujah. heavy burden. Will you lay it down? Lay it down. I'm giving you my heavy burden, Lord. Lion and lamb, you're strong enough.
Everything healthy grows. Everything healthy grows. A theologian in the 1800s named John Henry Newman, he said, growth is the only evidence of life. Again, growth is the only evidence of life. Now, all living things grow. If it's not growing, then it's either unhealthy, dead, or mature. Now, a child not growing is a tragedy. And if a believer doesn't grow to spiritual maturity, then that also is a tragedy. Because you know what? God wants you to grow up. Not only does he want you to grow up physically, he wants you to grow mentally, he wants you to grow emotionally, And he also wants you to grow spiritually. It says in Ephesians 4, verse 14, we are not meant to remain as children at the mercy of every chance wind of teaching, but we are meant to hold firmly to the truth in love and to grow up in every way into Christ the head. If you look at that verse, you'll see that the model of perfect maturity is Christ. It's not your pastor, it's not your father, it's not your mother, it is Jesus Christ. And we teach you that you were created to be like Christ. You were created to think like Christ. You were created to act like Christ, feel like Christ, and to talk like Christ. Because he is the model of perfect humanity. Jesus did not only come to save us from our sins, but he also came to show us how to live. I was raised Catholic and went to a lot of other churches after that. And one thing that bothered me was that people could go to church their entire life, their whole life, and still be spiritually immature. They could have been in church for decades, and they're still cranky. They're still self-righteous. They're still critical. They're still unloving. I'm going to keep going. They're still jealous. They're still envious. And they still gossip. How is it that they can hear that many sermons and that many Bible teachings and never really grow? This bothers me because as one of your pastors, I am accountable to God for your spiritual growth. If you are under our spiritual protection here at Lighthouse, the Bible says that I and the other pastors will one day give an account to God for how well we led you and helped you to grow spiritually. Peter says this to pastors in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 2. Shepherd, nurture, guard, and guide the flock of God that he has entrusted to your responsibility. As one of your pastors, as one of your shepherds, I am responsible to help you to grow to spiritual maturity. And one of the ways we do that is by knowing where you are spiritually. In fact, the Bible says in Proverbs 27, verse 23, be sure to know the condition of your flock. That's why we post QR codes everywhere, so that you can let us know how you're feeling. As a matter of fact, here's a QR code right now on the screens. Go ahead and pull out your phone and snap that QR code. And just, it's a quick two-question survey. Go ahead and take that and just take that survey. If something is going on in your life, if you have a question, a prayer request, if you're making a spiritual decision, you can also go to our website at lighthousesj.church. Click on Next Steps and go up and click on Contact Us. And one of the pastors will get the message and we will get back to you. Because we have to know the condition of our flock. God wants us to focus on building people because Jesus is going to build his church. Our command is to build the people and let Jesus build the church, helping them to grow to spiritual maturity. That's our job. And the goal found in Colossians 1, verse 28, it says, we continue to preach Christ to each person, using all wisdom to warn and to teach everyone in order to bring each one into God's presence as a mature person in Christ. One day, you're going to stand before God. And the goal is for you to stand up in front of God as a mature believer and not a spiritual baby in diapers. Thessalonians 4 verse 1 says, "Brothers and sisters, because of the Lord Jesus, we ask and we encourage you to excel in living a God-pleasing life even more than you already do." Even if you're already mature, God says, "I want you to grow even more. I want you to excel in spiritual growth." So how do you do that? How do you excel in living a life pleasing to God? How can we accelerate your spiritual growth so that you grow more than you've ever grown before? So I'm glad you came this morning. Welcome to Spiritual Growth 101. You have to understand what causes growth. You have to understand the principles of spiritual growth, and you have to understand the process that causes spiritual growth. Now, on your outline, there are a lot of myths about spiritual growth that we're going to debunk here today. One of the myths is that growth is automatic. No, it's not. You can grow older without growing up. There are a lot of Christians that just grown old and they haven't grown up. The fact is that growth is not automatic. Growth is a choice. Another myth, that growth can be instant. There's no magic pill for growth. It is a gradual process. Another myth, you can get growth by attending church. No, that's not it. It's not about coming to meetings. Jesus did not come to say, "I have come to that you might have meetings." No, he didn't say that. He said, "I have come that you might have life." So it's not just by attending church. The fact is, it is by developing habits. Another myth is that you can attain it by yourself, spiritual growth. Other religions teach that. They teach isolation. The Buddhists and the other, whatever, that you have to go up in a cave, separate yourself from other people, and then you will achieve nirvana by yourself to be a monk. But our Bible says that Jesus is the holiest person who have ever lived, and he was with the people. Jesus was at the parties. Jesus was at the marketplace because Jesus loved people. You can't grow without others. Another myth is that growth can be attained by measured. It is measured by beliefs. It is measured by how much you know. And that's not true because you only believe the part of the Bible that you do. With some people, the more Bible knowledge that they get, the more judgmental they get, the more critical they get, the more self-righteous they become. Jesus told the Pharisees that they didn't know Scripture. And that was a huge insult because to qualify to become a Pharisee, you had to memorize the Torah. If you don't know what the Torah is the first five books in the Bible. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. They had to memorize all of that. And Jesus told them that you do not know Scripture. Because the fact is, you can memorize it, but don't know it. Because you only know the part that you actually do. Titus chapter 2 verse 1 says, "Tell believers to live the kind of life that goes along with accurate teaching." Live the kind of life that goes along with accurate teaching. You need the Word of God, and not only that, but you also need the application of it. So it's not just measured by beliefs, it is by beliefs and behavior. And another myth that we're going to debunk is that you obtain spiritual growth by how you act at church. As soon as you step out the car, you can be yelling at your kids, yelling at your spouse. As soon as you open the front door, good morning. It can't be how you act in church, because in church, on Sunday morning, all you do is sit on your blessed assurance. It is more than how you act at church. It is how you act at home and in the world. See, true spiritual maturity, it is defined in James chapter 1, verse 27, and it says, pure and lasting religion in the sight of God means that we must care for orphans and widows in their trouble and refuse to let the world corrupt us. So in that verse, you see that there are two things. First is personal integrity. Don't get corrupted. And the second is public charity. Help people who need help. So how do you know you've reached spiritual maturity? The same way you know a plant or a tree reaches maturity. It bears fruit. An apple tree is not mature until it produces apples. A tomato plant is not mature until it produces oranges. You paying attention? Tomatoes. And so with you, you are not spiritually mature until you start bearing fruit. To paraphrase Jesus in Matthew 7, verses 16 and 17, he says, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. By their fruit, you will recognize them. If you see apples on a tree, then that must be an apple tree. Right? Everybody get that? It's not about what they say. It's not about what they know. It's not about how they talk. It's all about their lifestyle. How are they living? So, what is a fruit? Now, fruits, it's used five different ways in the New Testament. It refers to the fruit of your words. That's one way. It refers to the fruit of your thoughts, your mind. That's the second way. A third way that it was referred to was your acts, character, behavior. That's another fruit. Another fruit is based on your emotions. And another fruit is based on people that you bring to church, people that you bring to Christ, people that you are bringing to Christ. Now, how do you bear fruit? That's what we're going to go over today. There are eight laws that we're going to go over today of spiritual growth. And these are the things that we do at Lighthouse help you to grow. You need to understand them if you're going to become all God wants you to be. So, first one, the laws of growth. The first one is that spiritual growth is intentional. Spiritual growth is intentional. It is not an accident. It's a choice. You must choose to grow. Now, you are as close to Jesus as you choose to be. Don't blame your wife. Don't blame your husband. Don't blame the kid that's crying back there, that's shouting. Don't blame your parents. You are as close to God as you choose to be. Now, if you don't feel close to God right now, guess who moved? You did. If you choose to be a spiritual baby your whole life and stand before God and say, yeah, I never grew up, that's your dumb choice. We grow by making commitments. One of our goals here is to help you to keep making deeper and deeper commitments, because you grow through making commitments. At Lighthouse, we have like 6 levels of commitments, and we illustrate it through these 6 concentric circles. All right? Try to identify. You don't have to say it out loud. You don't have to bump anybody's elbows or anything like that. Just keep it to yourself and try to identify which circle you belong in. That each one of you is in one of these circles. Now, the first circle outside, the largest circle, is the community. Right? Everyone is in the community. And what is required of the community? The community is just people that are driving distance away from Lighthouse. Right? There's no commitment. They just live in the community. Our job is try to get them to come to the next circle, which is the crowd. The crowd are you all today. The requirement, the commitment for the crowd is to just show up. Just show up, and you're part of the crowd. But we don't want to stay there. We want to move you to the deeper circle. We want to move you from just an attender to a member, to a spectator, from a spectator to a participator. And the way you do that is to take class 101, and then you sign a membership covenant, you get baptized, and then you become part of the next circle, the congregation. We don't want you to stay there. We want you to go on to take class 201, which teaches you the habits of spiritual growth, and then you sign a maturity covenant, and then you become part of the committed circle. We don't want you to stay there. We want you to start using the talents and the abilities that God has given you. So you take class 301 so that you can discover your shape. And you sign a ministry covenant, and then you become part of the core. And then we don't want you to stay there. We want you to then take class 401, sign a mission covenant so that you can be part of the commissioned. And those people who are part of the commission, they go out into the community to bring them from the community to the crowd. You see, at Lighthouse, we are a factory. We are a disciple-making factory. That is our product. Identify what circle you are in right now and take the steps to become even deeper. But where is this idea coming from? This whole circles and commitments. This, if you follow Jesus, his ministry consisted of taking his followers through a graduated series of commitments. He started with, come and see. Come and see. And that's a very low bar of a commitment. At Lighthouse, we just tell the people in the community, come and see. Come and see. Just sit back and relax. Just come and see. But Jesus didn't stop there. He kept turning up the heat as he went on. He had 3 years with his followers, and he kept turning up the heat, and he kept redefining what it meant to be part of his life. He says that you're my disciple if you do this. You're my disciple if you continue in my word. You're my disciple if you love other people. You're my disciple if. And he kept defining what it means to follow him. Finally, he says, at the end of his ministry, he says, if you want to be my disciple, you need to take up your cross, deny yourself, and follow me. He did not say that on the first day. He did not go to Matthew and say, you're going to die for me. Can you imagine how would you respond to that? He built a relationship of love first. Until finally, right before he died, right before the cross, Jesus turned to his followers at the end of John chapter 6. He says, if you want to follow me, you've got to eat my flesh and drink my blood. This was an analogy. They didn't understand it. The people were like, wait, what? And then the Bible says that many people turned away from him and no longer followed him because what he said seemed too hard. So then Jesus looked at the 12 disciples and he asked them, you guys leaving too? But Peter stood up and he said, where are we going to go, Lord? You've got the words of life. You're God. Why would we leave you? He was able to say that because he was with Jesus for 3 years, growing, getting deeper, making deeper and deeper commitments. Jesus moved people through stages, and that's what we do here. We move you from come and see to learn and grow to go and tell. We don't want you to stay where you're at. Now, you need tools to help people to grow. Ephesians 4:13 says on your outline, our tools are ready at hand for clearing the ground and building lives of obedience into maturity until finally we all believe and become full grown in the Lord to the point of being filled full with Christ. So that is the tool that we use. Another tool that we use to help you grow is the thing that you're filling out right now, message notes. We give you notes to fill out. Now, a depressing statistic for all pastors. This was a study done by the United States Air Force. They see that people forget 90 to 95% of the things that they heard after 72 hours. So that means that you're going to forget this sermon by Wednesday. And the only thing that you're probably going to remember are the jokes. That's it. So we make you write it down lest you forget. Because the shortest pencil is longer than the longest memory. Think about that. You thought about it? That was good. You can write that down. I'll say it again so you can write it down. The shortest pencil is longer than the longest memory. You can't grow unless you remember it. You can't remember unless you write it down. So write it down. Somebody once asked me, why not have people open up their Bible and look up the verses? I have like 20 different verses, 20 different translations, and if I say go to here, open up your Bibles, go here, now go to here, go to here. It'll be a 3-hour sermon. Now, if you don't mind, we can start doing that. No? Okay. I can also have you read it aloud without worrying about other people reading different translations. It doesn't sound too good. We have it written down on notes just for your convenience. Because whether the Word of God is in a book, on your phone, on the TV screen, or on a piece of paper, it is still the Word of God. The other tool that we use is the four covenants that was mentioned earlier that we make you sign. The membership covenant in class 101, and that is to grow with other people in the body. The maturity covenant in class 201, that helps you to learn the habits of growth. The ministry covenant in class 301 that helps you to discover your shape and use it in service. And the mission covenant that you sign in class 401 that you use to develop your life message in the world. But so why sign commitments? Why do you want us to sign commitments here at Lighthouse? You sign commitments everywhere else. You can't buy a house without signing a commitment. You can't buy a car without signing a commitment. You can't get married without signing a commitment. You can't get a driver's license without signing a commitment. If you want to join any organization, at the PTA or AKA or whatever, you have to sign a commitment. If you want to get a job, you have to sign an employment agreement. If you want to eat at a restaurant, you have to sign saying that I'm going to pay this amount with the tip. You sign commitments everywhere else. So we make commitments to people all the time, and we sign them. So why don't we make commitments to God? We ask you to make those commitments. One time somebody came to me and said, why you want making us sign these commitments? I don't sign nowhere else. Yes, you do. Because spiritual growth is intentional. The second thing that it is, spiritual growth is not only intentional, but it's also incremental. It's incremental. We grow by having a plan, a process, a systematic track to run on, a plan for growth. You can't go on a diet without having a plan, right? That's just to try it, right? I'm going to try it, and it didn't work. You have to have a plan, and there are lots of diet plans out there. Why? Because not every plan works for everybody, but there's a plan that works for you. It works a whole lot better when you want to grow, and there's a plan for it. So we have a systematic, sequential process because we know what's true for physical growth. It's true for spiritual growth. We know that children grow through developmental stages, right? First thing that they learn how to do is breathe. Then they learn how to eat. Then they learn how to walk. And then they learn how to talk. And it's always in that order. Could you imagine a baby talking before they breathe? It can't happen. There are developmental steps. So we also have steps for spiritual growth in a certain order, helping you grow closer to Christ. It's about knowing Christ first, then loving Christ, then growing in Christ, then serving Christ, and then sharing Christ. That's the order. And these are the systematic steps to spiritual growth. Now, to help people remember this, we have a kickball diamond. Some people might say a baseball diamond, but I like kickball because everybody played kickball, right? Who did not play kickball? You didn't play kickball? Oh, you missed out. Oh, okay. So there's a picture of it right here, kickball picture diamond right there. Now, if you know the game, if you remember the game, getting on base was not enough, right? When you get on first base and then there's three outs, and it didn't matter. Right? The goal is to get all the way home. Right? So getting on base is not enough. Also, you can't take the base out of order. You can't decide to kick the ball and then run left and then run across and then run, touch the one on top and then come home. No. You have to go to first base, then second base, then third base, and then home. So we have here the diamond, and the way you move to knowing Christ is to take class 101, and then you're in the fellowship. Then you move on to class 201, second base, then 301, third base, and then you come all the way home by taking fourth base. Now, on the back of your outline, on the bottom, there's a customized growth plan. Now, I mentioned a couple of things. And if there is something that you recognize that you need to do, you can write it there. Now, everybody, this is a customized growth plan, meaning that it is custom to you, right? What you write down should not be the same of your neighbor, the person sitting right next to you. So don't copy. So listen to the message, because the message is not for the person sitting next to you. This message is for you. So write it down. Maybe in the first one, you can write down, accept responsibility. I need to start accepting responsibility. And maybe for this one, you need to write down, I need to take class 201 or 301, whatever class, I need to take class. Because 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18 says, our lives gradually becoming brighter and more beautiful as God enters our lives and we become like him. Notice the word gradually. There is steps to take. Okay, and that's the tool that we use. Now, spiritual growth is not just incremental and intentional, but spiritual growth is also personal. It is personal. It's got to be customized because there is no such thing as one size fits all. You can't just mass produce disciples using the same thing because everybody is different. We grow according to our shape. Those five things that make you unique, shape stands for spiritual gifts, heart, abilities, personality, experience. You'll learn more of this in class 301. These are the things that God used to shape you differently. Nobody is like you. Not even identical twins are exactly alike. You are shaped. Your shape not only determines your ministry, but it also determines every other thing in your life, including the kind of job that you should be doing and how you relate to the other different purposes in the Great Commandment and the Great Commission. For instance, your personality, it determines what kind of worship you like. Some of you like to just listen and meditate and reflect during praise and worship, right? And others like to sing really loud with hands held high. Even though they can't sing, they sing really loud, off key and everything, but that's okay. And sometimes, it's not here today, but sometimes if you listen carefully, you can hear a tambourine. But it's not here today. But that's okay. That's how you're shaped. The same thing is true about how you grow. We don't grow spiritually the same way. There are different learning styles. Some people learn by listening. Some people learn by reading. Some people, they just have to talk about it. They need to think out loud. Other people, they need to do it. I can't just read something. No, I don't want the manual. Let me just fix this. I got this. Let me put it together myself without using instructions. Those extra pieces are just extra. It's not needed. Some people learn through writing. They do. These are people that like to journal and they have diaries. And other people, they learn through connecting. They like to just be with other people. Now, when we do our campaigns, we try to engage all of these learning styles. You hear the message on Sunday. You read your devotions. You discuss it in a small group. You write in your book. You do a small service project at the end of the campaign, and you connect with other people in your small group. Now, what are some of the tools that we use to help people grow personally? One of them is the shape interview. Maybe you need to write that down. I've never done a shape interview before. This is done after you take class 301 and you discover your shape, and this is where you sit with someone to help you figure out, based on what God shaped you to do, what kinds of ministry you should be doing. Maybe you need to just write that down. I need to finish class 301. I need to complete my shape interview. Go ahead and write that down. Another tool that we use is we have a spiritual health assessment and planner. It looks like this. If you've never taken a spiritual health assessment, go ahead, scan the QR code, click on Contact Us, type in a message that you want a spiritual health assessment, and one will be emailed to you so that you can fill it out. It helps you plan the next steps for your spiritual growth. Because the Bible says this on your outline, 2 Corinthians 13, 5, examine yourselves to see whether you are living in the faith. Test yourselves. Once a year, we should all be doing this, by the way, you need to do a physical checkup. If you haven't done your physical checkup yet, go ahead, do your physical checkup. Who did not do their physical checkup yet? Get a physical checkup. Get that done. Not only that you need to do a physical checkup, you also need to do the same thing spiritually. You need to do an annual spiritual checkup. Find out, how am I doing? What am I learning? What help do I need? So those are the tools that we use. We use the SHAPE interview, and we also use the health assessment. Because spiritual growth is intentional. You choose it. It's incremental. You go through stages, and it's personal. It's got to be customized. The fourth thing is that spiritual growth is practical. Spiritual growth is practical. We grow by developing good habits. Spiritual disciplines is what it's called. In class 201, you learn some of these habits or spiritual disciplines. For instance, the habit of spending time with God every day, that's called a quiet time, where you sit down and you be quiet. You read a little bit of God, of the Bible, and then you talk to God, and you ask God, God, is there anything you want to say to me? And you just listen and see if he put any thoughts in your mind. That's a spiritual discipline. Prayer is another spiritual discipline. The habit of prayer. Bible study is another spiritual discipline. We want you to be self-feeders. Babies are fed. Adults feed themselves. Adults decide what, when, and how they eat. And there are different tools that you can use to consume spiritual food. There are devotions that you can read or listen to. There are sermons, not just here, but sermons online that you can watch and listen to. There are Bible studies that you can do. There you can start journaling. Now, there's a difference between a diary and a journal, all right? A diary is, this is what I did today. I did this, I met this person. Ooh, he made my stomach flutter, whatever. That's a diary, all right? But a journal is, here is what I am learning. Here is what I've learned today. This is what God showed me today. This is how God showed up to me for me today. So start journaling. If you are somebody who learned through writing, start journaling. So the tools is journal, audio devotions or devotionals, those tools. If you need help finding that, we have our discipleship pastor, Pastor Alex, who can help you to discover what you should be doing next. Whatever your next step is, go ahead, flip to the back, write it down. That's another tool that we use. We often give you practical things to do in the messages, right? Because sometimes we give you homework. Sometimes we give you like a next step because you only believe the part that you do. And if you just listen and do nothing, you should just stay at home. Spiritual growth is practical. Number five, spiritual growth is relational. We only grow in community with others. This is one of the biggest misunderstood facts of the growth among just American Christians for some reason. We think that we can grow on our own. We think we could just turn on like T.D. Jakes or Creflo Dollar or all of these things and just listen to them and I'm going to grow. If I've got my Bible and I've got Jesus, I don't need nobody else. That's wrong. You cannot grow without the church. You can get a whole bunch of head knowledge. You can listen to the Bible studies all day long, but that's not growth. Growth is all about love. Love God with all your heart. Love your neighbor as yourself. Those are the two most important commandments. You can't learn to love unless you're with other people. Especially unlovable people. You know who they are. Don't point at them. Don't look. Just keep your eyes up here. Keep your eyes up here. We grow best in community. That's why we're always encouraging you to join a small group. We grow by helping each other grow. The Bible says in Hebrews 10, on your outline, let us be concerned for one another, to help one another, to show love and to do good. Let us not give up the habit of meeting together as some are doing. Instead, let us encourage one another all the more. Is this verse talking to anybody? The habit of meeting together is another spiritual discipline. You can't do these things that this verse tells us to do on your own. You can't even do it here in a large group. You can't encourage somebody that you don't even know. Those things have to be done in a small group. So the tools that will help you grow relationally is to get in a small group or start a small group. If you're not in a small group, get in one or start one. If your group is boring, get in another one or start one. If you can't stand the people in your group, get in another one or start one. If you don't like the food at Applebee's, you don't just say, I'm going to stop eating. You go ahead and try Chili's, right? You keep eating. You try something different. So whatever it is, if you're not in a small group, get in one or start one. If you are in one and you don't like it, for whatever reason, get in another one or start one yourself. Here's another tool that we really that will really accelerate your spiritual growth, and that is to get a spiritual coach. Get a spiritual coach. If you're LeBron James, you still need a coach. Even though he coaches his own teams and everything, he's the GM, he's the player coach, he's the president, the owner of the Lakers, he's all of that. He even drafted his son, Bronny James. And he hired his own coach too, so he does it all. But even if you're that, you still need a coach. If you're Simone Biles, you still need a coach. If you're Beyonce, you still need a vocal coach. Every pro has a coach. So you need a coach in your spiritual life. You don't even have to call them coach. They can be a friend, a partner, a mentor, just somebody who will check up on you. In fact, you can, the third tool is to be a coach yourself, right? You can just go find somebody and say, you know what? You coach me and I'll coach you, right? Let's make that a deal. And that's it. So you might ask, how can I coach? I'm just a spiritual baby. Do you know how much you have to know to be a coach? Just one step ahead. That's it. If you've been a Christian for 2 days, you can help someone who's been a Christian for 1 day. You don't have to be light years ahead to be a coach. You just have to be one step ahead. Just start and just be one step ahead. All this stuff that I'm teaching you right now, I just learned it yesterday. Now, you're going to learn it today. Just go and teach it to somebody else tomorrow. You go and pass it on. So hopefully you're taking good notes so that you can teach it to somebody else. Why? Because you always grow the best when you pass it on. One secret about small groups is that the host grows the most. So if you want to host a small group, if you want to grow the most, try hosting a small group because the host grows the most. So be a spiritual coach or have a spiritual coach or both. Some of you right now feel a little stagnant in your Christian life, right? No? Nobody feel stagnant? There's a few people. There we go. Some of you might feel stalled. Some of you might feel like you're in a holding pattern. Some of you might say stuff like, I don't love the Lord like I used to. Church isn't as exciting as it used to be. I don't seem to get much out of it as I used to. What's the problem? Church didn't change. You did. Here's the thing. The last thing you need if you're stagnant is another Bible study. No, what you need is to give some output, not just input. Taking in and not giving out is what causes stagnation. In Israel, there are two great bodies of water. In the north, in North Israel, there's the Sea of Galilee. Right? And then in the south, there's the Dead Sea. And then there's the Jordan River that connects the two. Now, the Sea of Galilee is a beautiful, luscious lake full of lush. Fishers still fish over there. There's still commercial fishing going on over there. It is full of life. But the Dead Sea, however, is dead, literally dead. It's filled with salt, brine, and mineral content, and there's nothing living in that. It's so filled with salt, you can't even sink in it. And here are some pictures that shows that people swimming in the Dead Sea, they just sit up there and just float. I call those the Dead Sea floaters. If you ever want to just float out there, visit Israel and take a plunge into the Dead Sea. If you drown in this, that means you just trying to die. You tried to die. That you just gave up and said, that's it. Take me now. What is the difference between the Sea of Galilee and the Dead Sea? The Sea of Galilee, it takes in waters from the mountains and the snow from the north, and then it gives it out to the Jordan River. And then the Jordan River, it heads south, and then the Dead Sea takes it in and just takes it in, and it doesn't give it out. You will be a Dead Sea if you just learn and just take it in and just take it in and don't give it out. You have to give it out. Maturity is not an end in itself. Maturity is for ministry and mission. It's for you to give out. You need to balance input with output. If you only ate and never exercised, you're not going to grow. Well, you're going to swell. That's not growing. That's called swelling. You're going to swell. You grow with eating and exercise. If you're spiritually eating all the time, you just come to church every week, you go to Bible study, you listen to devotions, you're just getting fatter and fatter and fatter. Pretty soon, we're just going to have to roll you down the aisles. Just roll you down the aisles after service. And that's where we get the term holy rollers from. Look it up. It's true. What some of you need is not more input. You need output. You need to get involved. You need to be a coach. This verse could be talking to some of you right now in Hebrews 5, verse 12. By this time, you ought to be teachers. A tool that we use is small group and spiritual growth. The sixth thing that spiritual growth is that it is multidimensional. It takes all five purposes found in the Great Commandment and the Great Commission. You need more than just Bible study. You need worship experiences. You need fellowship experiences. You need discipleship experiences. You need ministry experiences. You need evangelistic experiences to grow. That's why a lot of churches don't really mature, because they don't focus on all five. They focus on one or maybe even two. But Lighthouse has a focus team that helps us to focus on all five, because we're to grow warmer through fellowship, deeper through discipleship, stronger through worship, broader through ministry, and larger through mission. That's the five multi-dimensions. If you go to a gym and you get a trainer, they're going to work on the area that you're weak at. So if you have like a weak shoulder, they're going to work on it to make it stronger. If you have weak knees, they're going to work on it so that you can get stronger at it. It's like physical therapy. In spiritual therapy, the focus team gets together and we're always asking, what do you need more of? Do our people need more worship? How can we get that to them? Do our people need more fellowship? How can we do that? Do our people need more spiritual growth? What resources do we need? Do our people need ministry? What kind of affairs can we have to promote ministries? Do our people need more evangelism? What else can we do to get people moving? We're always looking at all five dimensions, helping you to grow. Number seven, spiritual growth is seasonal. When you understand this, it will relieve a lot of guilt. Spiritual growth is seasonal, meaning that you grow in spurts. All right? Nobody grows at a constant pace all the time. The way you grow is that you grow a little bit and then you level off. You grow a little bit more and then you level off. You grow some more and then you level off. Can't get any higher than that, but you get it, right? You keep going. I'm not going to tiptoe. That's embarrassing. Nobody grows at a constant pace all the time. The way you grow is a little bit and then you level off. You grow in spurts. Now, remember when you were a kid, some of us, that was a long time ago. Some of us even longer than that. When you were a kid and you remember that time when you grew 2 inches over the summer? Anybody got that? I never got that. I'm still waiting on my growth spurt. Because right now I'm supposed to be 6'6". That was my projected growth. And I'm supposed to be in the NBA right now, but whatever, LeBron. But plants don't grow constantly. They grow in the spring and summer, and then they're dormant in fall and winter. They grow in spring and summer, and then they lie dormant in fall and winter. The same is true in your life. Some of you right now, you are going through a winter. I just don't feel like I'm growing right now. That's okay. It's a part of life. You go through spring and summer and then fall and winter. In fact, there are some things that happen in fall and winter that don't happen in spring and summer. In fall and winter, plants, they start to deepen their roots. They start to deepen their roots to prepare for the springtime when they're going to grow taller and when they're going to start bearing fruit. How do you know when you're going through fall and winter in your Christian life? When God takes away your feelings. When you start to feel dull, you don't feel anything anymore. You don't feel close to God anymore. You're going through winter. But when you keep doing those spiritual habits, even when you don't feel like it, when you keep going to church, when you keep being in a small group, when you keep reading your Bible, when you keep having a quiet time, God is growing you on the inside. God is deepening your roots. God is teaching you to live by faith, not by feelings. If you always felt close to God, if you always relied on you feeling close to God, then you will live by feelings and not by faith. Even if you feel like God is a million miles away, live by faith. Never doubt in the dark what God has shown you in the light. You're going to grow in spurts. You don't just grow constantly. Because of this, we intentionally program around it with this tool. And this tool is campaigns. We use campaigns. Campaigns are growth spurts. This past year, we started off with the Transform campaign. Years prior, we did 40 Days in the Word and all of these different campaigns where we focus on a topic intensely for a period of time, and then we back off. You can't just keep pushing people all the time. When you want to push a big rock up a hill, you push, 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 and then you stop and rest. And then you push, 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 and you keep going. That's what happens. You grow, then level off. You push, and then you relax. That's how people grow. And the last one, number 8, spiritual growth is incarnational. It's incarnational. What does that mean? I've heard that word before. That's a word that you can write down and then you can use it to impress somebody now. That word means that Jesus Christ is living inside of you. Galatians 2:20 on your outline says, I have been crucified with Jesus Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I live in my body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. The goal of the Christian life is not to live like Jesus. That's not the goal. It's not I'm trying to be like Jesus. It's actually, it's letting him live inside of you. The goal is not imitation. The goal is inhabitation. Not imitation, inhabitation. Because you can't and I can't neither. We have to let him live through us. It's me relaxing and saying, Jesus, help me to love people. Help me to be kind to people. Jesus, help me to always tell the truth. Jesus, help me to keep my commitments. Jesus, help me to trust God. Jesus, live through me. None of this that we just talked about can happen on your own power. It's God who works in you because of the cross. 1 Peter 2:24 says, Christ carried our sins in his body on a cross so that freed from our sins, we could live life that has God's approval. His wounds have healed you. You need to understand how important the cross is. It did two things. First, it freed you from having to pay for your own sins because Jesus Christ has paid for your sins. And then second, it gives you power to live the kind of life we've been talking about. My prayer for you is the last verse on your outline, 2 Corinthians 13:9, is our greatest wish and prayer is that you will become mature Christians. The last thing that we're going to do to close is that I want everyone to take out your phone right now. Take out your phone. If it's a flip phone, you can't participate on this. If it's an Obama phone, you can't participate in this. Go ahead and scan that QR code up there on the screen, or scan the QR code on in front of you, on the chair in front of you. And something will pop up, the link tree for Lighthouse SJ will pop up. And the first link there is, it says spiritual growth plan. Go ahead and click on the spiritual growth plan. And I'm not asking much. This, whatever you say here, is going to go to all the pastors, everybody in Focus Team, and we're going to help you with that. The question is, what's your next step? You can look at the notes that you've been taking throughout the message today and go ahead. You can just write down one thing. That's the only thing you need to do. Just write down one thing. If you have more than one thing that you want to do, you could go ahead and just write that down. Just write it. Type it in. Write it in. Half the year is gone. What are you going to work on for the rest of the year? If you don't do anything, if you don't fill this out, we just wasted 45 minutes. It's worthless. Because you're not going to do anything about it. The moment you walk out of here, you're going to forget it. So write it down. Type it in. What is it that you're going to type in? You can type in, I need to accept responsibility for my spiritual growth. Go ahead and you can write that. You can type in, I need to complete class 201 or 101 or 301 or 401. Go ahead, type that. I need to do a spiritual health assessment. Go ahead, type that. I need to get serious about a quiet time again. Type that. I need to find a devotion to listen to or read every day. Go ahead, enter that in. You have space. I need to get in a small group or start a small group. I'm going to get a spiritual coach. And I'm going to be a spiritual coach. Go ahead, type that. Take the next few minutes, pray about it. Take this moment of silence and just write it down. Tell me what next steps you're going to take in your spiritual growth. The music just died. Set in the mood. Can I get some piano music playing? Okay, that's good. There we go. Keep going. The mood is set again. Go ahead. Let's go back. Go ahead and write it down. Type it in. Go ahead. Do that.
Amen. Thank God for Pastor Ace. I praise God for all the different teaching styles that God has given us in this church. A lot of times we don't really recognize how important it is for someone to give us visual aids. Because I know that when stuff was popping up on the screen, you were like, you know what? That makes sense. That makes sense. For those of us that are visual learners, that works that way. And so I thank God for Pastor Ace and what he's done today in his labor. Give the Lord a hand of praise for that. One of the things that stood out to me this morning that he was really driving home is that spiritual growth is output. It is very easy to come to church and just receive. You go back home and you do what you do and everything else, but you recognize that life has not changed. Well, in large part because it is a stagnant pool that you've created of just receiving. And it's time for us to learn how to give out the things that God has given us. Share it with other people. Connect with other people. I like that he talked about that the host of a small group usually learns the most, and that is fundamentally true. Why? Because the host has to study for the lesson, right? He has to go and, or she has to go and teach the lesson. And so, therefore, they put in the extra time to make sure that they're learning what they need to learn so that they can give it out to other people. And so, by the grace of God, we encourage each and every one of you to, number one, get in a small group. If you're interested in potentially joining a small group, let us know. We want to know where you're at and what you're interested in. So another thing is just that even as he gave you those QR codes, let's say even though it was up on the screen for a good amount of time, maybe you missed it. That QR code right in front of your seat, you can still scan that and still get the same information. Amen. All right, so if I could just direct your attention to the monitors, we got a few quick announcements, and that'll be that.
Lighthouse, we are inviting you to get connected with everything that is happening at our church through our Church Center app. It has everything you need in one place. Browse the directory if you need to find information for another member. Check out information for upcoming events. Giving is made easy with just a few clicks of a button. Don't wait in those long lines. Check in your kids for Children's Church. Register for any one of those great events that we have happening at our church. Join a small group. Volunteer and be put on the volunteer schedule. Listen to past sermons. Download the Church Center app. our next announcement is another exciting announcement. We're going to be doing Family Fun Night. Our Family Fun Nights are going to be the last Friday of every month during the summer months. So that's June, July, and August. On the last Friday, we're going to open up our doors and we're going to have game nights. We're going to have movie nights. We're going to have all things happening at the same time. So we're going to have games over there with kids and with families. We're going to have ice cream socials. We're going to be doing s'mores. There's going to be so many fun things that we're going to be doing. So come, don't forget to mark your calendars. On the last Friday of every month during the summer, we're going to be doing Family Fun Night. It's important to be together as a family. And so we're going to be encouraging that, encouraging you to come. See you there.
Hello, Lighthouse family. Make sure that you join us this Wednesday. Matter of fact, every Wednesday at 6 p.m., we have the official Bible study where we get a little deeper into the Word. We unpack it with the Hebrew and the Greek, all those good things, the hermeneutics and fancy stuff. But you won't know any of those things unless you come and join us every Wednesday, 6 p.m. We'll see you there.
Amen. Okay. Y'all missed the last Family Fun Night, which was just this last Friday. There was quite a few folks that didn't make it, and hopefully, God willing, you'll make it to the last one. Let me say one thing, though. Sister Coco really knows how to play dominoes, okay? Don't let the smooth taste fool you, okay? This lady was beating us like we stole a government mule, and, you know, I'm waiting for my redemption so that we can go back and sit at the table and I'll show her what's going on. So, no, but seriously, when we have these events and things like that, it is very important that you understand and know that this is for us. This is for our community. We don't have to wait till Cousin Ray Ray have a party and then we go and have a good time there. No, we do that in God's house. We do that in God's house. We have fellowship in God's house. We play cards, yes. It's not a sin to play cards. I know some of y'all was taught that it was. It's not a sin to play cards. It's a sin to do certain things with cards. But, you know, at the end of the day, it's a good thing to be a Christian. It's a good thing to be connected to another body of believers, to be able to come alongside of them and actually exist as a person. Amen? I mean, I had a good time with just a few of us there. Coco, did you have a good time? Of course you did. You beat us. So, yeah, she was like, oh, yeah, I'm here every week. If you still want more, I'll give it to you. That's her attitude about this thing. No, but in all honesty, we want the people of God to remain connected. And so, please, on the last Sunday in August, please come and show up. Bring your family. Bring some friends. Help them come and have healthy competition and healthy connection with people who love God and want to introduce the world to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Really quickly, if this is your first time here, there's a few different ways that you can give to Lighthouse if you're interested in doing so. We have our, if you're physically here in the sanctuary, you can give by going to one of the three boxes that we have in the back towards the foyer or even this one here, or you can text to give 84321. Or if you have the Church Center app, you can go there or go to lighthousesj.church, click give, and you can just go ahead and take care of that from there. If all hearts and minds are clear, let me have you stand to your feet as we prepare to receive our benediction. Our benediction is going to come out of Ephesians chapter 3, verses 20 and 21. Let's receive our benediction. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or even think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. And the people of God say, amen. If you're interested in prayer, Pastor Lowe will be up here, and Pastor Ace will be up here for prayer, and I'll be standing up here myself. So please, if you're interested in prayer, please come up. And glory.